Good evening. Thank you. I'm Ed Derrick. Your program says that Alan Leshner will be making some welcoming remarks. Unfortunately, he can't be here. So I'll make just a few. I direct our Center of Science Policy and Society programs here at AAAS. Delighted to see so many of you here. I can see some of you underneath the lights. And perhaps there are some others in the overflow room who can hear us. This event is something that our dialogue on science, ethics, and religion does every year. I have a lecture about this time of year and a discussion on issues that intersect interests of our center and of AAAS, that is the intersection of science and society. And so, again, we're delighted to have you. I'm going to bring up the director of our dialogue on science, ethics, and religion, Jennifer Wiseman. The program itself has been around since 1995. Jennifer's been with us 4 years now, 3 years. And we're delighted by the energy and efforts she's been putting into an array of efforts. I think you'll see some of them going on the slides behind. Jennifer will explain some more. But again, thank you all for coming. I hope you enjoy the event tonight. Should be a fascinating discussion. And so let's welcome Jennifer.
Good evening and happy holidays to everyone. This has evolved into an annual ritual now, our DoSER holiday lecture and reception. And I'm always curious to know if just as many people would show up if we didn't have the reception part. But trusting that you're just as interested in the content as the food, we're glad you're here. And this is always, I think, an enjoyable time to think about some rich topic of our day that involves forefront science and also the interaction with our larger worldviews, our concerns about ethics, our religious worldviews, our societal values. And tonight we're going to explore the very hot topic of genetics, in particular the human genome and what we're learning about humanity through this new science or this advanced science, and talk about the implications of that for society. Before we get into the program, though, I did want to tell you a little bit about our DoSER program, the Dialogue on Science, Ethics, and Religion. We are involved in several projects getting underway. One is working with seminaries where religious leaders get their training. We are hoping to launch right away a program to help seminaries that are very interested in incorporating science into their core programs to be able to connect more with scientists and to be able to be more facilitated in incorporating forefront science into their core education programs. We're about to launch a major survey of public religious views regarding science and scientists and those perceptions, as well as the perceptions of scientists regarding religious people and their views, trying to find out where those connections and mismatches are and seeing what we can do about that to improve understanding and perceptions. And we are ever interested in helping the scientists in our society who come to us wanting to understand better how to relate science to diverse audiences with diverse beliefs. So we are very active right now, and I would like to also introduce to you Dr. Peyton West, who's our projects director. I don't know where Peyton, there she is right there, who's a lot of energy behind these programs. And Bethany Spencer, who is in and out of the room now, has helped us with much of our program, and including setting up the reception tonight, which we greatly appreciate. Tonight, let me just make sure I've mentioned some of our work. Oh, I do want to invite you all to visit our website to find out more about the various projects that we are doing, including but not limited to the ones I've mentioned. And to look at our Facebook page and join us on Facebook if you're a Facebook person, because that's a lively dialogue that we try to keep going, and we appreciate the efforts of people like Faith Tucker to keep that that community active. Tonight, We want to talk about genetics. And increasingly, we are hearing in the media that new research reveals that certain human traits are linked to specific genes. These include physical traits such as height, health-related traits such as Alzheimer's, and even behavioral traits such as, quote, religiosity. We also hear such phrases as, quote, the blueprint of life in the context of research in genomics. What are we to make of this? If true, these reports would seem to have a major impact on how we view our own behavior and cast doubt, perhaps, on our notions of free will. For some, the idea of genetic determinism may create a kind of fatalism that erodes moral values. In terms of religious perspectives, even a slight degree of genetic determinism would seem to directly contradict much of what religious texts say about human responsibility. Tonight, Denis Alexander will explore the notion of determinism, focusing at first on the science and what it is really telling us about the relationship of genes and behavior, and then on the implications of this science to our notions of freedom and responsibility. As a respondent, Steve Paluson will bring neuroscience into the conversation in recognition of the fact that neuroscience raises similar questions. From his perspective as a journalist, he will consider the similarities between what research in neuroscience is and suggests about the links between physical characteristics in the brain and human behavior and the conversation that's playing out in the public at large. I'll first introduce Dr. Alexander, and then when his comments are finished in about 50 minutes, I will give a more thorough introduction of Steve Paluson. Dr. Denis Alexander is the Emeritus Director of the Faraday Institute for Science and Religion at St. Edmund's College in Cambridge, England, where he's also a fellow. And you've seen, I think, prior to our DoSER slides being circulated here, if you were here a few minutes early, you got to see his advertisements of what's going on at the Faraday Institute for Science and Religion. They hold short courses throughout the year, and I have participated in those. I find them very interesting, so I encourage you also to check them out and attend. Dr. Alexander is also the former chairman of the Molecular Immunology Program and head of the Laboratory of Lymphocyte Signaling and Development at the Babraham Institute in Cambridge. He writes, lectures, and broadcasts widely in the field of science and religion, and his books include such titles as Creation and Evolution, Do We Have to Choose?, and The Language of Genetics. Denis has also co-edited with Ron Numbers the recent collection of essays entitled Biology and Ideology, From Descartes to Dawkins. And since 1992, he's been editor of the journal Science and Christian Belief. So we are delighted and honored to have Dr. Denis Alexander as our guest this evening. And so, Denis, if you would like to come up, we'll see if we can get switched over to your slides. And let's go ahead and welcome Denis to the podium. Can you find your slides
I can
again?
Probably find my slides.
Okay.
Okay.
There you go. All right.
Okay. Well, just while I'm looking for my slides, I would like to thank you all for your very warm welcome, and it's a great privilege to come back here to Washington, and I think I probably. Got my slides there, and there we go. Not quite. There they are, I'm hiding. Good, so as Jennifer's already been mentioning to us, one of the striking features of cultural life over the past decade has been the way in which our language and our public media have become permeated with this discourse about genetics and about DNA. And of course, the reasons are not hard to discern when you think of the fact that the full draft of the human genome was sequenced and published just back in 2004, revealing that precise sequence of those 3.2 billion nucleotides or genetic letters that we find in every chromosome in our cells. And since that time, of course, genomics has become an incredibly important focus topic for research activity as well as for comment and discussion in the public domain. Then in a further major step forward, this was just a few months ago now, the results from the ENCODE project were published. Just a whole slew of papers came out, about 30 different papers came out. ENCODE stands for the Encyclopedia of DNA Elements, and it aims to discern the functional possibilities of every single portion of the genome. The main paper in this series starts, in fact, by emphasizing a phrase that Jennifer has already picked up, that the human genome encodes the blueprint of life. The genome is often referred to as the instruction manual, giving the impression that the human body is somehow assembled from the manual, much as you might put together a piece of furniture from those kits that you get from the store. The phrase, "it's in his or her DNA," has come into our daily language to suggest that a particular characteristic is intrinsic, maybe rather difficult to change. Brad Pitt, whilst discussing US gun control, suggests that it's in Americans' DNA to own a gun. Won't make any comment about that at all. The cloud computing service provider Oxygen assures us that our security is in their DNA. American Express is integrating social media into its marketing DNA. London has apparently had 2,000 years of urban DNA, whatever that means. I have no idea what that means, but anyway. The situation's not really helped by the insistence of the media to keep reporting the discovery of a gene for this, that, or the other. There are mean genes, gluttony genes, gangster genes, liberal genes, conservative genes. Even the whimsical suggestion of a geneticism gene that predisposes some people to think the behavior is caused by their genes. Whereas, of course, I hope we all know that a gene is just a stretch of DNA that encodes a protein or an RNA molecule, and that's it. There is no single gene that encodes for any kind of behavior, indeed in any kind of organism. It simply doesn't exist. Now, scientists, I think, for the most part, have been careful to avoid such language of a gene for any particular trait, given that they don't exist. But the transformation of a story from a serious scientific paper into its media presentation can be quite dramatic. For example, here's a paper published in the Proceedings of the National Academy of Sciences, 2009, very respectable journal, reporting findings by a collaborative research project originating from Brown University. And the authors here are reporting a correlation between a form of the enzyme monoamine oxidase that generates low enzyme activity, and they're reporting that correlation between that low enzyme activity and high levels of aggression in human subjects who've been provoked. Now, perhaps unwisely, the authors refer in the abstract to the nickname for this particular gene, the warrior gene. But on the whole, the paper is just a regular piece of scientific reporting. Now let's look at the press release coming out of Brown University associated with publication of this paper. Warrior gene predicts aggressive behavior after provocation. Subjects penalized opponents by administering varying amounts of hot sauce. It's actually true. They did, actually. It was part of the story. But that's the press release. Now, with that kind of press release, I don't have any... I sympathize with the media and the blogosphere who now go on the next step as they publicize this report out in the... here's the ABC News website. We have the headline, "One in Three Men Have Violence Gene. Scientists Say It's the Warrior Gene." Although the story was at least pitched in this case in a way that emphasizes the free will trumps all story. So, as we all know, in today's news-hungry world, the pressure is extremely high on folk out in the media to maybe dramatize the story in order to grab the headlines, in order to serve the needs or expectations of a particular readership. But notice in this particular case that one in three men, including everyone here tonight, do indeed have this particular variant of the monoamine oxidase gene. Well, does it matter if some people start thinking that they are like puppets with the genes pulling the strings? I think there's plenty of evidence that it does matter, actually. So there's much data showing that the belief that one's capabilities or destiny in life are determined in some way has a negative impact on a range of psychological traits and human behaviors. Give a more positive or negative label to different groups of school children who have previously been shown to be equivalent in cognitive and academic testing, and they will then perform according to the expectations implied in the label given to their group. Even the act of ticking a checkbox at the top of a test sheet to indicate race and sex can influence subsequent scores. Now, of course, everyone these days knows that genes and environment interact to generate living organisms such as us. There simply are no genetic determinists. No one seriously thinks that our complex behaviors or our life decisions are determined by our genes, despite this rather famous comment from Jim Watson that we used to think that our fate was in our stars. Now we know in large part that our fate is in our genes. Neither, equally, are there any strictly speaking environmental determinants. Everyone knows that we're the product of a complex gene-environment interaction. And thereby, I think, lies a problem. For it is precisely in the use of such dichotomous language that we find a fragmented view of human personhood in which these rarefied forces of genes on one hand and environment on the other are kind of pulling the person in different directions, as if the human personality was some kind of battlefield of competing influences. This dichotomous language, as you probably know, is inherited from one of my countrymen, Francis Galton. He was Darwin's first cousin, who first introduced the contrasting terms nature and nurture in his book of Men of Science, Their Nature and Nurture, 1874. As Galton himself pointed out, the phrase nature and nurture is a convenient jingle of words, useful because it separates under two distinct heads the innumerable elements of which personality is composed, adding that no carefulness of nurture can overcome the evil tendencies of an intrinsically bad physique, weak brain, or brutal disposition. Don't forget, he was a Victorian. And in his book on twins, Galton concluded that nature, and I quote here, nature is far stronger than nurture within the limited range that I have been careful to assign the latter. It was really Galton who set the parameters for the discussion right up to the present day. Browse the shelves of the genetic section of any bookshop or indeed Amazon, 140 years after Galton, and you'll find books with titles such as Nature or Nurture, Nature and Nurture, The Nurture of Nature, Nurture by Nature, Nurture Through Nature, The Nature-Nurture Debates Bridging the Gap, Nature or Nurture, The Great Brain Debate, and even the rather worrying title, Nature versus Nature, Nurture, Why We Kill. So I feel rather sorry for both authors and publishers faced with the challenge of finding fresh recombinations of the word nature and nurture, and surely we are already close to the limit. Now, many of these books, I have to say, contain much that is valid and good, and my purpose here is not to be dismissive about the great gains which have been made under this banner of nature and nurture, but simply to point out, and I'm certainly by no means the first to do so, the power of language to shape the interpretation and presentation of science in ways that are not always the most enlightening. I think it's certainly difficult for us to rid our minds of dichotomous language. Hot and cold, light and darkness, extrovert, introvert, Republican, Democrat, nature, nurture, genes, environment. Often people we'll talk about nature versus nurture as if there are two kind of essences, almost platonic essences, one called nature and one called nurture, which somehow compete. So what I want to do during this lecture is to move the goalposts, to forsake the dichotomous language, and in its place to reframe this discussion about genes and environments within a matrix, which I think does more justice to contemporary biology. And I hope we'll see in the process just how important it is for that rebuilding of the matrix to take place in order to preserve key issues of human identity, human freedom, and human uniqueness. So in place of that dichotomous nature-nurture framework, which is no longer, I suggest, fit for purpose, let's go for a framework that, as I say, is more faithful to contemporary biology, focusing on how development endows us with our particular traits. And I'm going to use a new acronym, DICEY, Developmental Integrated Complementary Interactionism, and I'm going to explain that terminology as we go along. It's certainly not as jingly as Galton's nature-nurture phrase, but as I say, at least I think it does greater justice to the science, and at the least we can see this as four useful pegs upon which to hang various ideas. By the way, DICEY, or DICEY, for a classicist in Latin, or dici for theologians, means to be said in Latin. That's not why I chose it. It happened to be noticed later on. Now, I'm going to apologize here for the next few minutes for those who are biologists here who will be familiar in what follows, but I hope, given this is an interdisciplinary lecture, that you might find some illustrations of this dicey concept useful. Let's start with a newly fertilized human egg, a zygote. What is inherited from the parents is not naked DNA, which by itself can do nothing, but it's a complex system of DNA, RNA, proteins, nutrients that together operate to regulate cell growth and division. And in fact, the human egg, just prior to fertilization, contains at least 3,000 different proteins, 7,500 different messenger RNAs, and many thousands more of small RNA molecules. And they're all involved in regulating gene expression. So by itself, DNA would be as useless as a bit of software on a CD without any computer to run it on. And right from the beginning, there are two types of environment: the immediate microenvironment of the DNA within the cell, and then there's the macroenvironment, which includes the fallopian tube down which the zygote soon starts traveling, plus, of course, the mother, plus the mother's environment, and so on. All of these various environments are completely integrated from the very moment of fertilization. And so a key part of the microenvironment of a gene is other genes. The genome operates as an integrated system. One key finding of the ENCODE project that I just mentioned is that at least 20% of the genome, perhaps more, involving around 500,000 distinct DNA sequences, is involved in regulating how the DNA is expressed, how the genes are expressed. There are only 21,000 roughly protein and encoding genes in the genome. There are around 16,000 RNA genes. But these, in turn, are regulated by these hundreds of proteins called transcription factors, which are the switching mechanisms. They switch the genes on and off. A vast and complex network of interactions. Genes, like people, function according to the company that they keep. And in the zygote, it's not the DNA which causes development to begin, but rather the protein transcription factors inside the zygote, which are inherited from the mother's egg, which regulate. Those are the proteins which regulate the which genes in the DNA are then switched on and off. So if you like, proteins are the players in the DNA orchestra that cause the genes to play an integrated symphony of life. And there are causal networks here which are operating in all directions. Now, following implantation, the fetus is now exposed to a whole new array of influences from the macroenvironment, coming from the mother's blood, of course, via the placenta, oxygen, hormones, glucose, proteins, lipids, maybe alcohol, maybe drugs, all are becoming available. Fetal size, interestingly, is regulated by the size of the uterus, so that surrogate mothers will tend to give birth to bigger babies than the rather perhaps short parents from which that particular zygote came, the biological parents. During pregnancy, the mother will change physiologically and mentally. She, in turn will choose to change her daily environment. Later in pregnancy, the fetus can taste and smell and hear certain stimuli inside the womb in ways that affect the child's behavior following birth. This explains why the newborn will choose its mother's voice and face over other females, but not if the mother was depressed during pregnancy. And so it's increasingly been recognized that what used to be known as innate behaviors are actually behaviors established during fetal development as part of this complex gene-environment integration. The next step in human development, of course, occurs at birth, when the newborn is now bombarded with this whole new array of sights and sounds and smells and touch and people and cats and dogs and other fascinating environmental phenomena. And the physical development of the infant brain is critically dependent upon such exposure. So the infant brain is not just a miniature version of the adult brain, but it's a self-organizing system that only self-assembles correctly if the right inputs are available at the right time. The adult brain contains around 10 to 11 neurons, but in total, twice as many brain cells are made during the developing fetus, with about half of these being pruned away during the development. At the peak, growth time in utero, about 250,000 new fetal brain cells are being produced every minute, an extraordinary phenomenon of development. But those fetal brain cells are not like the adult brain cells. They're actually neuroblasts. They're immature cells. They've yet to develop into neurons. And so in the newborn, synaptic connections are sparse. The axons are not even myelinated. And it's the experiences, then, of the growing baby that help to structure that whole complex synaptic architecture that's going to come along in the first year of life. This, for example, shows that striking increase in synaptic network density from the newborn up to 2 years old. The average weight of the infant's brain triples during the first year of life from around 300 to 900 grams due to the growth, not in the number of cells, but due to this vast growth in the number of synaptic connections, the myelination, the great arborization, as it's called, the tree-like appearance of the synaptic density of that growing infant's brain. And there are certain critical periods at which sensory input is vital for the development of specific brain areas. If the baby is blind from birth and the visual cortex doesn't develop normally, permanent visual impairment can incur. Children born with congenital cataracts in both eyes have large permanent deficits in motion processing, whereas children who develop cataracts from 6 to 12 months have no such deficit. So the brain displays considerable plasticity during development, and it's the wider environment that interacts with a growing child that the brain is then put together and programmed, as it were, to grow into a functioning child's brain. Now, if we now continue along that developmental trajectory into adulthood, the integrated interactionism, that's me at the top, yeah, between the genes and the microenvironments become even more striking. Of course, the growing individual makes key lifestyle choices about their diet, exercise, the levels of stress, alcohol intake, smoking, clean environment, polluted environment, whatever, drug taking and so on. Even choice of friends, choosing a lonely environment, sociable environment. All of these factors and more are now feeding back to affect the epigenome, the epigenetic modifications of the individual's DNA that regulate the expression profile of their genes. Epigenetics refers, as I'm sure you know, to all those chemical modifications which switch genes on or off. They include actually the chemical markers on the DNA itself, as well as modifications on the proteins that surround the DNA. So that if genetics provides the hardware, if you like, of inheritance, then epigenetics provides the software. Or if the DNA sequence is like the musical score on the page, then epigenetics is all those Italian words, fortissimo and the like, that give instructions as to how the notes should be played. And so epigenetic regulation provides a key communication pathway leading from the macro via the microenvironments to the genome. So, DICEY, there we have it in this brief overview. We've seen how development of the organism is the key. It's an ongoing process that continues until death. All the components of the process are tightly integrated, and there's a continual interaction between all the various components of the genomic system, microenvironments and the macroenvironments. And many complementary systems are happening in parallel, subverting the dichotomous language of linear causal relationships. And so the DICEY concept simply bypasses the notions of nature and nurture. The goalposts have been removed. There are no two separate reified entities that interact with each other. They simply don't exist. The insight of DICEY, the developmental approach, is that 100% of the phenotype, that is the morphology, the appearance, the behavior of any complex organism involves genetics, and 100% involves the environment. They're all involved all the time. Now, thinking about the development of a highly complex system like the human is a challenging exercise, so I hope you'll forgive me for a moment if we think about something a little bit simpler, a black forest cake. Now, most of the cake is flour. This is a genuine recipe down the bottom, by the way. Most of the cake is flour. It's more than 50%. No flour, no cake. Less than 1% is baking powder. No baking powder, no cake. Around 8% is chocolate powder, no chocolate cake. No correct oven heat, no cake. And so the cake is the product of a highly complex developmental process in which the proportions of the recipe are indeed critical to the eventual outcome, but it would be odd and indeed impossible to try and assign proportionality to the original components in the finished product. By that stage, for example, the baking powder no longer exists. So the initial components have been chemically transformed. The cake as a whole, if you like, has emergent properties which are non-reducible to its initial components. So this brings us to the important C word in DICEY, which is complementarity. There are dozens of different complementary interactionist narratives going on during the process of development. Proteins and genes, proteins and cells, genes and environments, cells and organs, synapses and memory, choices and mutagenesis, and so on and so forth. And these are all necessary. They're all ongoing important stories in weaving together the complexity of the human individual. There are many, many narratives to be told, and different disciplines, of course, specialize in telling the different narratives. And that in itself can lead to a problem. It's very easy for an investigator embedded in one particular discipline to start thinking that their particular narrative is the only one that counts. And this is no less true of geneticists and molecular biologists than of anyone else, slipping either overtly or covertly into the error of ontological reductionism, which is sometimes given the nickname nothing buttery, the idea that human identity or the description at one particular level is nothing but that particular level of description. And the truth of the matter is that we need all those different levels of description that we were just looking at to do justice to the complexity of the human individual. There's no need to choose one particular narrative over another as we think about human development, although clearly for some traits or other, one of those many component contributions may be more or less important. It's also good to remember that the notion of causality becomes quite problematic when considering such complex systems. The philosopher, the late J.L. Mackey, spoke of causes as insufficient but necessary parts of unnecessary but sufficient conditions. Now, to unpackage that tongue-twisting definition a little, we can ask the question as to whether human personalities would be as different as they are without the various genomes that different individuals possess. I would want to say, certainly not. Those variant genomes play a critical part, so they are a necessary part of the story. But equally, I think it would be mistaken to assert that a particular variant genome causes a particular personality. In reality, there are many tributaries of the river of life flowing together to cause the emergence of the unique human individual, and the variant genome is but one tributary. Human life starts with the inheritance of a complex system, and it's with the dynamic characteristics of that ongoing complex system that human identity is to be found. Now, given the power of developmental biology to paint a picture of human identity for us that renders the language of nature and nurture out of date, we might well ask why such dichotomous pairings retain their traction in public discourse. And one reason is undoubtedly the proliferation of books and articles and media articles on the latest genetic discoveries, which still use this dichotomous pairing as the framework within which to publish those particular results. But I think there's more going on here than that. A powerful contributor to the maintenance of dichotomous thinking comes from the world of behavioral genetics and its very distinctive definition of the word heritability. Each human individual picked randomly from anywhere in the world varies between around 0.5 to 1% of their genome. New mutations are constantly being contributed to the human gene pool. It's recently been estimated, based on whole genome sequencing, that a newborn contains, on average, 60 new mutations not found in its parents. Much of that genetic variation between individuals makes no difference at all because it lies in non-coding or non-regulatory regions of the genome. But it's estimated that on average, each individual, each of us here in this room, contains around 250 to 300 variant genes that are expected to make a difference to gene function, variant that is, in comparison with a standard reference genome sequence. So the challenge of behavioral genetics is to try and find out whether genetic variation between human individuals has anything to do with differential behaviors. And that can only be attempted by studying variation within a particular population using twin and adoption studies. And I'm only going to mention this rather controversial field rather briefly, and so not do it justice, but it is important, I think, to realize how the field tends to keep alive this idea of nature-nurture dichotomy, and also, very importantly, the very technical meaning that the word heritability carries in this field compared to its use in our everyday speech. Quantitative behavioral genetics seeks to separate out the influence of genes and environment on variation in a particular trait. And the meaning of trait in this particular context can mean anything that you can vary and measure between individuals in a given population: IQ, personality, sexual orientation, religiosity, hours per week spent watching television, whatever you can measure can be tackled in this particular kind of way. Most traits, not all, most traits vary with a normal kind of distribution. What heritability study then does is to calculate the proportion of the total inter-individual variance that is associated with either genes or the environment. The heritability is therefore defined as the proportion of the variance in a trait in a specified population that can be ascribed to genetic variation. And so a typical heritability study proportions the variance according to three components: genetic influences, H, shared or common environmental influences, C, and non-shared or unique environmental influences, E. So the common environmental influences include factors such as socioeconomic status, the diet, the parenting style, that kind of thing, all those items which contribute to the similarity of the trait under consideration. Non-shared environmental influences are those that make a person different with respect to a particular trait. For example, might be bullying at school, differing levels of drug use or alcohol intake, that sort of thing. Now, because each of these components is a proportion of the total variance, they add up to one. They're all squared for statistical reasons. H squared plus C squared plus E squared equals one. And I promise you, this is the only equation we're going to have this evening. So the genetic influence plus the shared environmental influence plus the non-shared environmental influence is said to equal the total influence on the trait. So if you have a heritability of one, that entails that variations in genetic influences are counting for all the variants in a trait with no environmental influence at all. Similarly, heritability of zero means no genetic influence. Now, it should be noted that H squared, the heritability, is dimensionless, and it only makes sense when considered alongside those other two components. And in fact, heritability can be expressed as a percentage, which is often misinterpreted as if it referred to the proportion of the inheritance of a trait, when all it represents really is the percentage of the total variance in a particular population. So in the classic approach, the variation of a given trait in a population of monozygotic, that is identical, and dizygotic, that is if fraternal twins raised in the same family, is measured. The investigator looks at how closely the scores between the twin pairs correlate with each other. Correlation measures how similar the deviations in one variable are to deviations in another variable. And we do the math, and we find, for example, that if the correlation regarding IQ measurements for identical twins is 0.86 and for non-identical twins is 0.6, then the heritability is twice the difference between the two, or it's 0.52. So in this case, we say the heritability of IQ is 52%. In practice, for twin studies today, various biometrical modeling techniques are used that they take into consideration a whole range of other assumptions and complications which are involved, such as genotype, environment, interactions and correlations, and that kind of thing. But this gives you the kind of basic idea of what's going on. Now, that field of quantitative behavioral genetics has a very long history of controversy. It continues to the present day. Every year, there's a cluster of books published, some passionately passionately defending the whole field, some passionately attacking the whole field, and so forth. I think it's fair to say, actually, even some of the practitioners in the field don't always really agree amongst themselves on some fairly key points, actually, involved in this whole approach. There are a whole range of complications. We know, for example, now that identical twins are not necessarily identical, even at the DNA level, due to mutational changes that occur after embryo splitting. In fact, there are more than 400 papers that have been published on twin pairs that are discordant for a wide range of physiological and psychiatric conditions. And even at birth, twins certainly vary at the epigenetic level. In fact, the epigenetic differences at birth appear to be greater in the identical rather than in the non-identical twins. Now, time doesn't allow to review all these various complications in the methodologies, but I just want to make a couple of general points which I think are important in this whole approach. The first point to notice is that heritability has gained an extra meaning over the last few decades. So in addition to being used as a synonym for inheritance, it now also has this newer technical meaning as used in population genetics, the proportion of variation of a trait in a population that can be attributed to genetic variation. And that's something quite different from its earlier meaning. And unfortunately, what can happen is the meaning of the word often elides, slips from one meaning to another, even in the same text, in the same article, in the same book. And that can give the impression that a particular trait in a particular individual is actually caused 50% by their genes and 50% by their environment, which is not what heritability is about at all. Let me illustrate by a simple example. This is not new to me. It's one used by Patrick Bateson from Cambridge. Firstly, we notice that nearly all people have two legs. When they only have one leg, it is nearly always due to an accident, in other words, due to the environment. So the variation in legginess in the population is 100% environmental and 0% heritable. Now, that sounds odd because everyone knows that you need genes in order to have legs. It's just that in practice, the genomic system responsible for leg building during development nearly always encounters the same environmental context, and so the system, thankfully, invariably builds two legs. Likewise, the heritability of having a brain is zero, because there is no variation, as far as I know, in a population in this particular trait. So we note here, and this is really important, that heritability in the context of quantitative behavioral genetics actually tells us nothing about the complex interplay of components that we were thinking about in the context of the DoSER model that, as a matter of fact, lead to the development of traits. The second point to note about heritability is that its very method of calculation perpetuates this rather, I think, unhelpful dichotomous distinction between nature and nurture, between genes and environment. If we really want to understand how individuals end up with the particular traits they do, that we can't really look at populations to achieve that. The problem is that once mathematical values are assigned to three different proportions of variation that, taken together, are said to add up to one, then I think it's inevitable that those proportions will come to be seen as reified entities that in some sense interact or compete in generating something. In reality, correlations between variance and population cannot play that kind of role, but the perception generated in the reports of heritability values is often along such lines. Now, if we were only our genes, to come back to the title of this talk, then certainly that would entail some form of genetic determinism. But determinism refers to individuals and to their choices, not to variation in a population as studied by quantitative behavioral genetics. We can define determinism in its hard form as the thesis that given our particular genomes, our lives are not really up to us and are constrained to follow one particular future. There's also a softer form of genetic determinism which states that given our particular genomes, our lives are more likely to follow one particular future, which is clearly something rather different, and you might want to say isn't really determinism at all. hard genetic determinism belongs to medical genetics, where a particular pathology does often involve constraint, one particular feature, very sadly, and that is, of course, the whole arena of medical genetics. But as far as soft determinism is concerned, it is the burgeoning field of behavioral molecular genetics which is most relevant, either through genome-wide association studies or through genome expression studies. Various candidate genes are being put forward, which are then looked at in a population to see if they correlate with certain kinds of human behavior, certain kinds of traits. And to illustrate that, I want us to look at one particular example that will well illustrate some of the positive results coming out of this field, but also some of the challenges which are involved. This relates to impulsivity, a much-studied trait for which a recent meta-analysis of 41 different studies generated a heritability value, that is defined as we've just been defining a heritability value, based on additive gene effects in the range of 30 to 50%. That is, remember, that's referring to the variation, proportion of the variation in the population to which you can draw the inference that genes are involved. So in 2010, a paper was published in the journal Nature describing a Finnish population in which a particular gene variant was found to correlate at greater than chance in a population of prisoners characterized by severely increased impulsivity. Even the generally restrained journal Nature gave the news item reporting these results the headline, "A Gene for Impulsivity," a phrase carefully avoided by the authors of the study and indeed in the news report itself. As I mentioned earlier, it goes without saying, there is no gene for impulsivity. But unfortunately, once such inaccurate phrases are used in the scientific literature, one can't really then blame the media and the blogosphere for their own headlines on such reports. Here we go, including the violent gene, genetic mutation found only in Finnish men that makes them fight. Impulsive, it may be a genetic mutation. Scientists discover gene that triggers violent anger. Drunken rage could be in your genes. Note the deterministic language. Here you have a single mutant gene as a powerful causative agent triggering violent behavior in men over which apparently they have no control. The reality, if you read the article, it's a good article, well done piece of work, but the reality is much more mundane. The investigators discovered a novel mutation, we'll just call it Q20 star here for the purposes of our present context, in which a change in a single genetic letter is introduced into the stop codon of the gene encoding one of those 15 serotonin receptors that we all have in our brains. Serotonin, as you probably know, is an important neurotransmitter involved in the central nervous system in a whole wide range of behaviors, including mood, behavioral changes, sleep, that sort of thing, appetite, and so on. The Q20 mutation results in a very low level of the serotonin receptor protein in the brain. So this novel mutation was discovered in 17 out of 228 cognitively normal, albeit violent, individuals displaying high impulsivity compared to its presence in 7 out of 295 normal controls. In other words, there was a threefold higher tendency for the mutant Q20 to be found in those scoring high on impulsivity than in those who were average with regard to this trait. So what are we to make of this correlation between a mutated gene and a violent subpopulation of offenders? Well, we note that out of the total 5.3 million population of Finland, it was estimated by these authors that about 106,000 individuals are carriers of this Q20 mutation. That's around 2% of the population. But the number of Finns currently in prison, it's very low, by the way, remarkably low, it's around 3,500. So clearly, the vast majority of people with a Q20 mutation are not violent offenders. But having said that, it cannot be excluded that carriers of the Q20 mutation might be predisposed towards greater impulsivity following some perhaps negative treatment in childhood, treatment that might not have the same impact on a child who does not carry the mutant gene. Second, it should be noted that each individual worldwide varies in around 1 in 1,000 of the DNA nucleotides, or genetic letters, making a total of 3 million single nucleotide polymorphisms, as they're called, in a cohort unique to each person. So the frequency of genetic letter changes or polymorphisms often varies from one ethnic population to another as a result of population flow, ancestral patterns of migration, that kind of thing. And so it's quite possible that the 17 violent offenders in this study also share hundreds of other SNPs, single nucleotide polymorphisms, in common besides the Q20 mutation, which also identify them as a particular cohort. But it's possible that none of these SNPs, not even Q20, are necessarily anything to do with impulsivity. Correlation does not necessarily entail causation. So the conclusion of this study is that it is of interest that the Q20 mutation in the serotonin receptor gene correlates with a small subpopulation displaying high impulsivity associated with criminality, but the vast majority of carriers of this mutation are nonviolent, law-abiding citizens. And so this study per se, despite the media headlines, provides no justification for a belief in any kind of genetic determinism, neither the hard form nor the soft form. That suggests that given our particular genomes, our lives are influenced to follow one particular future. Nevertheless, it's entirely plausible that there are cohorts of gene variants, dozens, probably hundreds actually, which do correlate with individuals with a tendency to be impulsive and which thereby contribute to the rich diversity of the human population. Now, what would happen if there was a gene that correlated with nearly all the criminality in the world? Could we then talk about causation? Well, as it happens, there is. Out of 131 countries worldwide, an average of 96% of the prisoners carry the SRI gene, the gene responsible for maleness, found on the Y chromosome. So universal is the correlation between the SRI gene, without which we males would not be male, and criminality, that it's unlikely that other genetic correlations will ever be found between a particular gene and criminality that surpasses this one. And yet, for some reason, we still hold nearly all males responsible for their criminal actions, and we put them in jail as soon as they're convicted. Furthermore, we note that most people, thankfully, who possess a Y chromosome go through life without committing a crime. And so the SRI gene doesn't cause criminality, although clearly we cannot go to the opposite extreme and say that it has nothing to do with human behavior at all. So taking the field of behavioral genetics overall, a picture is emerging of thousands of variant genes which, taken together, contribute to the rich diversity of the human population. The data are entirely consistent with the process of developmental integrated complementary interactionism. Variant genomes unique to every person on Earth who has ever lived or who ever will live, are surely intimately involved in the development of these broad swathes of our different personalities, providing the overall contours that guarantee the unique identity of each human individual. So are we only our genes? It seems not. What about genetic determinism? I've carefully avoided entering the philosophical debate about free choice and determinism, which can rather easily end up in a rather sterile discussion, I think. But my approach here as a biologist is rather different from that of the philosophers. I would maintain that the profoundly human experience of choosing freely is a Darwinian trait as universally characteristic of our species as having a nose or two legs. If people do not experience that trait, then they should be seeing a psychiatrist. You cannot function normally in society without experiencing that trait. So, given that fact, simply a sociological observation, we may then ask the question as to whether there are any genetic data that might undermine such an observation and make us think that the experience is illusory. And apart from certain severe genetic pathologies, I suggest not. But despite that conclusion, the rhetoric of biological determinism lives on. Talk to geneticists and they will disavow any kind of strict genetic determinism. But the kind of language often used as their results are conveyed to the public does suggest sometimes that the genetic story is the one that really counts, the one that's really running the show. Listen to this language in a news feature that came out just over a month ago in the journal Nature entitled The Anatomy of Politics from Genes to Hormone Levels. Biology may help to shape political behavior. The author writes that, and I quote, an increasing number of studies suggest that biology can exert a significant influence on political beliefs and behaviors, reporting that genes could exert a pull, notice the language, a pull on attitudes concerning topics such as abortion, immigration, the death penalty, and pacifism, close quote. John Hibbing, a political scientist at the University of Nebraska-Lincoln, is quoted as saying that, and I quote, it is difficult to change someone's mind about political issues because their reactions are rooted in their physiology, close quote. Note the dualist language involved here and its assumption of determinism. Genes and physiology here are seen as something different from us and our mind, and they seem to be controlling us, so we can't even change our mind. Now, for sure, we're the product of a developmental, integrated, complementary interactionism, which might indeed make it more likely that we follow one particular course in life rather than another. But the choice is ours. If you're tall, it might be slightly more likely that you become a basketball player than if you're short. But lots of tall people, I happen to be one of them, never play basketball, whereas lots of short people love it. So, genes maybe influence us, but they certainly don't control us, as if our genes and our genomes were somehow operating in a separate space from the rest of personhood. There are no genes for gluttony, nor for impetuosity, nor for crime, nor for religiosity, nor for voting Republican or Democrat. However, there are people who choose to be or to do all of these things, so hopefully not at the same time. And with that thought, I will close. Thank you.
Thank you, Denis, for that very interesting and provocative talk. And so now to offer some reflections from the perspective of a journalist who's been very engaged in discussing the interaction of science with societal perceptions, we're happy to have Steve Paluson, who will offer about 15 minutes of comments. And he'll also bring in some thoughts on neurosciences, which is also related to public perceptions of our ability to have free will in our behavior. Steve Paluson is the executive producer of a Peabody Award-winning syndicated radio program that's called To the Best of Our Knowledge, which is produced at Wisconsin Public Radio and syndicated nationally by Public Radio International. Steve has written for Salon, Huffington Post, The Atlantic Online, The Chronicle of Higher Education, The Independent, and other publications. His radio reports have been broadcast on NPR's Morning Edition and All Things Considered, and his recent book, published by Oxford University Press, is entitled Adams and Eden, Conversations on Religion and Science. So Steve Paluson, welcome.
Very bright up here. Thank you. It is a great pleasure to be here. When I was originally asked to respond to Denis's talk, my first reaction was to say, you have the wrong guy. I'm really not an expert on genetics, and quite frankly, I did not want to sound like an idiot in front of all of you. But then we talked a little bit more, and I realized that there is a perspective that I could add that I think would be useful. I just finished producing a six-hour radio series on the science of consciousness for my syndicated program, To the Best of Our Knowledge, which, incidentally, will start airing on WAMU on February 3rd, and then going along for the next 5 weeks, so there is my shameless plug for the evening. As I was putting together this radio series, I interviewed dozens of neuroscientists and philosophers, as well as artists and other visionary thinkers, and I came to realize that consciousness is just about the most fascinating subject in all of science, and I would argue the most significant intellectual issue in the science and religion debate, but which we can talk about more later if you would like. And there's a basic question that comes out of this. Just as Denis has asked, are we only our genes, there's a follow-up question, are we only our brains? And if everything that happens in our minds can be reduced to brain chemistry, where does that leave us? There's also a profound philosophical and moral question here. Do we have free will? Was your decision to get a cup of coffee this morning or to check out the websites you looked at this afternoon really your choice, or did your brain somehow program you to do it? Now, you may think this is a ridiculous question. Of course you have the freedom to make these choices. So let me tell you what a few prominent scientists are saying these days. The well-known atheist Sam Harris, who's also a neuroscientist, just wrote an entire book blasting the idea of free will. He says, and I'm quoting, "Free will is an illusion. Our wills are simply not of our own making. Thoughts and intuitions emerge from background causes of which we are unaware and over which we exert no conscious control." The neuroscientist David Eagleman agrees. He recently wrote a long article in The Atlantic arguing that we need to rethink our legal system because free will no longer holds up in the face of modern neuroscience. How can we hold criminals morally accountable if there's something wrong with their brains that caused them to commit the crime? I recently interviewed Michael Gazzaniga, one of the founders of cognitive neuroscience, who's just written a book called Who's in Charge? Free Will and the Science of the Brain. In our interview, he said, and I'm quoting, "Free will is an arcane concept that's just out of place given our modern knowledge of how the brain works." He went on to say that we should have a category of legal judgment where we say the person is guilty, responsible, and insane. We should not have guilty by reason of insanity. I then asked Gazzaniga how we can have personal responsibility if we live in a determined universe. And he replied, "The brains are on automatic, but people are free." So I said, "Well, then we don't live in a deterministic world." He paused for a moment and replied, "I don't see it that way. The brain is determined, but people are to be held responsible for their actions. That is the prize outcome that we want humans to have." Well, okay, let me cite one more critic of free will. The University of Chicago evolutionary biologist Jerry Coyne wrote a column in USA Today, of all places. He said, and I'm quoting, "You may feel like you've made choices, but in reality, your decision to read this piece and whether to have eggs or pancakes was determined long before you were aware of it, perhaps even before you woke up today. And your will had no part in that decision. So it is with all of our other choices. Not one of them results from a free and conscious decision." And he goes on to say, and I have to quote this again, "Our brains are simply meat computers that, like real computers, are programmed by our genes and experiences to convert an array of inputs into a predetermined output." So there you have it. Your brain is just a meat computer. Kind of depressing, isn't it? Now, a lot of the scientists who say we have no free will refer to the groundbreaking and quite ingenious experiments by Benjamin Libet back in the 1980s. He hooked up his test subjects to EEG monitors and asked them to signal exactly when they became aware of their decision to push a button. Well, it turned out that Libet could detect an electrical change in their brains, an average of about half a second before these people started to flex their wrist or lift their fingers. In other words, half a second before we're aware of making a decision, our brain has already set in motion the electrical impulses to make that decision. Our conscious minds are simply doing the bidding of the involuntary actions within our brains. I should add that a number of tests since then have corroborated this experiment. So, is this a slam dunk against free will? I'll come back to Libet a little later, but I think it's really interesting the way these studies have been interpreted. The assumption is that free will is all about what you might call conscious agency, what happens in our conscious minds, you know, all those higher cognitive functions that involve judgment and analysis and decision-making, what many people would consider the pinnacle of human evolution. The assumption here is that we are not actually making decisions if these impulses rise out of the hidden subconscious part of our brains. And I have to say, this is a really strange and rather bizarre way of thinking about who we are. It's kind of like we have two selves, Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde. There is the civilized, conscious, higher self, and then there is the subconscious, this roiling, shaggy beast that lurks below the surface, secretly calling the shots and dictating what we really think and do. But isn't all of this, the conscious and the subconscious, actually who we are? A better model might be to say there is a constant feedback loop between what happens in our conscious and subconscious minds. Let's go back to the question of how we decide to do something. Consider what an artist does. Let's say a novelist is struggling over how to write the next chapter. Then maybe she's eating ice cream or lying in bed at night, and voila, inspiration strikes, and she suddenly realizes, oh, that's what I should do with this character. So how do you explain that? My guess is that her subconscious has been churning away, sorting through the story she's been mulling over. And sometimes you just have to let go of your analytical frame of mind and let the answer bubble up. Some people would describe this as tapping into the more intuitive right hemisphere of your brain. And I have to say, this happens to me all the time when I'm producing my radio show. I'm trying to figure out the right combination of interviews, and I get to a certain point where I'm stuck, and sometimes I just have to walk away. If I'm lucky, a creative solution will pop into my head, seemingly out of nowhere. And do I really think, gee, I wish I didn't have that aha moment because it didn't come out of some hard-earned intellectual struggle? Are you kidding? We'll do just about anything to get those insights. In fact, creative people have often gone to great lengths to unlock certain parts of their brains, at times even using mind-altering substances. I'll give you a couple of examples. Samuel Taylor Coleridge famously wrote his great poem, Kubla Khan, after an opium-inspired dream. When he woke up, he started writing the poem, and then someone knocked on the door, and he lost the thread of what he was writing and could never get it back. The lesson there, don't answer the door when you're in the middle of a creative surge. And to take an example from science, the Nobel Prize-winning biochemist Carrie Mullis used to go tripping on LSD. As a result of one of those acid trips, he says he visualized the molecular concepts that led to his discovery of the PCR chain reaction. Now, I'm not saying we should all start dropping acid and then wait for inspiration, but there's a reason that creative people sometimes go to extraordinary lengths to gain access to their subconscious selves. The successful artist, and I would suggest the happy, well-adjusted person, learns how to tap into other, less analytical parts of ourselves, and in the end, this is all part of who we are. Now, there's another problem with the idea that you are just your brain. It's probably not even accurate to say that consciousness happens only in our brains. Just last night, I was in New York where I moderated a panel discussion at the New York Academy of Sciences on what happens in the brain when we listen to or perform music. One of our panelists was the jazz pianist Vijay Iyer, who's won a pile of awards, in fact, just this past year in Downbeat magazine, including Best Jazz Artist and Jazz Album. In other words, he's a really big deal. Now, it so happens that Vijay also has a PhD from UC Berkeley in music perception and cognition. He talks about what is called embodied cognition. He says he's not just making music with his brain. It's a physical activity that involves all kinds of things: his mind, his fingers, the touch of the piano keys, how he responds to the audience in front of him. And all of this comes into play when he improvises. Before our event last night, I had called up Vijay the week before, trying to figure out what he wanted to play as part of our event. And he said that he didn't want to decide beforehand. He needed to sit down at the piano and basically take the temperature of the room, get a sense of what the audience was like, and then it would come to him what he wanted to play. According to Vijay, the idea that you are just your brain goes back to Cartesian dualism, to Descartes, who believed there was a clear split between mind and body. Now, just to be clear, I'm not bashing neuroscience. This is an incredibly exciting time for neuroscientists. They're making remarkable discoveries about how our brains work, especially with functional MRI and the other sophisticated tools they now have. But there's a growing tendency to try to explain everything by brain function, and entire new disciplines are popping up with interesting names like neuromarketing, neuroaesthetics, even neurotheology. There's also an emerging backlash against this kind of thinking. Some critics have called it brain porn or neurotrash. The British neuroscientist Raymond Tallis calls it neuromania. In his new book, Aping Mankind, he writes, "You would have to be remarkably resistant to brainwashing to resist the claim, endlessly repeated, that we are our brains. The notion that our consciousness, our self, our personality, our character, personhood itself are identical with activity in our brains is so widely received that it seems downright eccentric to profess otherwise." Tallis goes on to say, and I quote again, A brain in good working order is, of course, a necessary condition of every aspect of consciousness, from basic perception to the most complex constructed sense of self, but it does not follow that this is the whole story. Many aspects of everyday human consciousness elude neural reduction. The point is that we don't actually know how the neural circuits in our brain produce our conscious experiences. I recently went to a panel discussion at the University of Wisconsin, where I'm based, and the discussion was called, "What is the Mind?" There were several prominent scholars there, and the first thing that the neuroscientist on the panel said was, "The mind is what the brain does." So in the Q&A session, I asked all the panelists, "Do you think we'll ever be able to isolate the precise neurons to explain why a particular thought pops into our heads?" They all said no. So here's the paradox. It's almost scientific orthodoxy to say that the brain generates all of our conscious experiences, but no one has a clue how this happens. Now, this is a really interesting moment in the history of brain science. Neuroscientists estimate there are close to 100 billion neurons, that's billion with a B, in the human brain, and trillions of synapses. The complexity is staggering. The human brain has been described as the most complex object ever found in the universe. And now some very brave neuroscientists are trying to create a complete map of the neural circuits of the brain, what's been called the connectome. It's an unbelievably difficult project, far harder than the Human Genome Project was. But suppose future scientists manage to create this map of the brain, to isolate the neural correlates of our mental experiences. Would we then understand human consciousness? I doubt it. Because there is a profound explanatory gap between the physical stuff in our brains and our immaterial minds, which are not made of anything. You can't weigh or measure a thought or a feeling. Now, I think it may be possible somewhere down the road for scientists to match specific brain images with particular thoughts or feelings, but only if the test subjects tell the scientists what they're thinking. What we'll have is correlation, but that's not explanation. And what we really want to know is, why do we have these particular thoughts or feelings? Where do they come from? Why did we have that weird dream last night? And I just don't see how you can make claims about neural determinism without answering those why questions. Now, there is an emerging movement to try to bring together the tools of brain science with what people say about their own subjective experience, essentially melding together the third-person perspective of science with the first-person accounts of actual experience. The Buddhist philosopher Alan Wallace has said that what we really need is what he calls a contemplative science. And there's a small group of neuroscientists who are working with experienced Buddhist meditators, people who've spent their lives training their minds. And certainly one of the most fascinating discoveries of recent decades is how plastic the brain is, and specifically how skilled meditators can change the way their brains work, can actually rewire their brains as a result of how they think. I want to come back to Benjamin Libet, the scientist we were talking about earlier, who did those experiments that have been cited by critics of free will. He wrote a paper a few years before he died called, "Do We Have Free Will?" Libet himself was not actually willing to say no, and he had a rather nuanced argument. He said the role of conscious will is not to initiate a voluntary act, but rather to control whether the act takes place. Your conscious will then selects which of these initiatives you act on and which ones you say no to. He thought this understanding of free will lined up pretty well with various religious and ethical teachings, the kind of control yourself directives you find in the Ten Commandments. Libet then asks, must we accept determinism? And he said there are problems with the deterministic worldview. For one thing, it really doesn't hold up at the level of quantum physics, where there are no certainties. Or only probabilities about when a particular event will happen. Libet then goes on to say, and I'm quoting, "There is an unexplained gap between the category of physical phenomena and the category of subjective phenomena. My conclusion about free will, when genuinely free in the non-determined sense, is that its existence is at least as good, if not a better scientific option, than is its denial by determinist theory." So what should we make of all of this? First of all, this is a golden age for the science of the brain. We are learning amazing things about how our brains work. But I think we need to be careful about what lessons to draw from these discoveries. It's entirely possible that science will never be able to explain some parts of our lives. And that's okay. It's okay if science cannot explain everything that's real. It doesn't mean you're anti-science. It doesn't mean you're trying to sneak religion in through the back door. You can be a complete naturalist and take the position I've just outlined. You can also be a religious believer, because I really doubt that brain science will ever be able to explain away spiritual experience. In the end, I think we could use a little more humility, because often the most answer, often the most honest answer is simply to say, I don't know. Thank you.
So, are we only our brains, and are we only our genes? It would seem the answer is coming out no, but we're in the middle of a very interesting conversation this evening. So I would like to ask both of our speakers to come up and join us. We're going to take about the next 10 minutes or so for a little bit of discussion, and then we'll start our reception at about 6:40 or so. So if we can get ready for that. We will take a few questions from those of you in the audience, and if there are those of you in the overflow room who would like to come in and ask a question in the auditorium, you can feel free to do that. We have two microphones here, so if you want to line up, we can only have time for about five or six questions, but we will do that if we can. Remember, it's too bad that Dr. Leshner is not here with us this evening, because he explains the definition of a question very clearly. But the gist of it is this: a question is a short, succinct statement that ends with your voice going up at the end. So this is not, I know we all have our own great thoughts that we'd like to share, but this is really a forum to ask a brief, succinct question to our speakers this evening so they can share a little bit more from their perspective, and we can therefore get four or five questions in here. I would like to, as the host here, I would like to be able to ask the first question. And we've heard a little bit about both neuroscience and genetics, but I would like to understand something, if you can answer this briefly, about the relationship between the two. Are these always a separate conversation as to whether we're determined by our genes or whether we're determined by neuroscience? Or is, in some sense, neuroscience seen as kind of a product of genetics? So you know, are our brains determined by our genes, and therefore genes trump? I mean, I don't understand the relationship between these two things. Do either of you have a comment about the interrelationship between genetics and neuroscience? It might be not close enough.
Should I just speak up loud, or? Okay, I think we need it for recording, so I will keep speaking until something happens.
Yep, no, yes, no, no, okay. Okay. Well, should I just speak up?
Yeah, just go ahead.
Or do you want, does this speak here? You know what, why don't I, here, do you want, we can pass it back and forth.
We can pass it to
the front. Okay, let's do it that way.
Sorry about that.
Why not? Okay. Good, so I would want to say that obviously the whole biological system is completely integrated, and that's part of the idea of this rather clumsy acronym, I know, this dicey acronym. The fact that the whole biological system, including the genome, the genetics, the epigenome, the neuronal system, are completely integrated from the word go, meaning the zygote, onwards, up, onwards to death, the whole developmental process. But I think it's worth pointing out that in any biological organism, including ourselves, there's sufficient genetic information, clearly, to build the kind of brain that specifies what kind of species we are. So there has to be sufficient information there which can enable the neurons to find, roughly speaking, the right places in the brain so they will form the right kind of structures. If that wasn't the case, we certainly wouldn't be humans. I think what's fascinating, though, is that, as I was mentioning, twice as many neurons are made in the fetal brain as we have in our adult brains. And there's then a great process of pruning, which involves, in fact, apoptosis, programmed cell death. So what the neurons are doing is they feel out their synapses. When they make a successful synaptic connection, then they actually stay alive. So that's a they then get a survival signal, which will enable those synaptic connections to be reinforced, and therefore to stay where they are. And the ones that are not successful are actually pruned away. And so there is actually a Darwinian, if you like, natural selection process going on, even in the development of our brains, in such a way the brain is molded and shaped by its own experience and the input that's going on. But all of our brains are being influenced the whole time. This evening, I have been intending and aiming to change your brain. Okay, so all our synapses are slightly different from when we came in. It's a sobering thought. So recently there was a, sorry, I just have one more point. There was a recent lovely paper on Einstein's brain. It's the second paper that came out, because fortunately it was all sliced and photographed very, very nicely, very soon after death. And there's all kinds of stuff one can say about that from the paper, but there's one interesting little knob on the motor cortex, which is quite expanded in his brain. That's reckoned to come from his childhood experience of very intensive violin playing. When you play the violin, you play a musical instrument, you're definitely changing and expanding certain parts of the brain. So I think this, so just as with genes and the rest of our personalities and the rest of our human identity, so with brain, I mean, it's all integrated system.
Okay, thank you.
And I'll just add one brief comment. I think part of the reason why sometimes we seem to have these different conversations about what's happening at the genetic level versus what's happening at the brain level is it's a disciplinary question. And so, are you talking to neuroscientists or are you talking to evolutionary biologists? And obviously, when you think about it, there's a lot of crossover, but they tend to come out of different fields, and the neuroscientists will talk about particular things. Philosophers of mind will tend to focus on the brain, on the mind. And I think there are some other questions that come up if you come out of more the evolutionary history side of it. So it's just, I mean, that's true with all kinds of things. I mean, if you're a physicist, you're going to approach some of these questions in different ways as well. So it's, which is not to say that ultimately they're all part of the same conversation.
Great, thank you so much. All right, we're gonna take 9 minutes here. We'll get as many of these questions in as we can. Why don't we start over here?
Thank you so much. In the first lecture, I really appreciated the way you kind of deflated the pop science impression of genes as control or absolutely determinative. But I'm curious, part of our curiosity about genetics seems to be more of an ought than an is question. If something is genetically determined, we think it's part of our identity or something we should respect in a way that we don't if we think a certain environmental impact or social impact had a high predictive value for certain future behavior. Homosexuality, obesity, gender all kind of fall into this category. To what extent should scientific findings inform our ideas of who we are? I am this, I am impulsive, versus our bodies is something we have. I have a tendency to be impulsive, but I subvert it.
Thank you. I rather like the latter way in which you put it, that we have, I mean, clearly we all do have various predispositions which come from an incredibly complex array of influences which involve our genomes, involve our environments from the word go onwards, from our zygote onwards. So, and we have these predispositions. I think the great danger, I mean, one of the dangers, obviously, of saying, talking about a gene for impulsivity is it then gives people a label and it defines people in a certain kind of way. Which then becomes a self-fulfilling prophecy. Once you give a label to people, they tend to behave according to the label. And I think that's terribly important in education as well, isn't it? That when we give kids a certain label, I mean, I just think it's terrible, and I don't know when this practice stopped, and I still shudder when I think about it, that, I mean, there were certain schools around in our countries in previous eras where the kids were lined up according to their IQ. You have a high IQ, you stand at the front. You have a low IQ, you stand at the back, and you line up. And this, isn't that an awful thought? So once you label people with some sort of label, then they will perform according to the labels you give them. So I'm deeply suspicious of labeling. I think that everyone is, aside from severe genetic pathologies, people have those capacities to change and to do something differently. And I just think we need to fight against the language that constricts people into some sort of predetermined way of doing things. And I just think that's a dangerous kind of approach myself. And I don't think it's justified by the science either, which is equally important.
Thanks. How about over here?
Yeah, with regard to randomness and determination, we're not only our own genes, but the microbiome we're learning more and more about. Clearly, that influences our immune system. Our immune system affects the way our brain behaves. So I'd appreciate your insights into that interaction as well, and that component of the system.
Thanks very much. No, absolutely, yes. As you probably know, we have 10 times more bacteria in our bodies than we have our own cells. We have 100 bacterial genes in our bodies for every one human gene. It's an amazing thought. And they're incredibly important for our health and our well-being. And also some very interesting papers coming out now on relationship between our microbiome and actual brain function. And it's more animal work so far, but there's some human stuff as well, which is more perhaps speculative. But yeah, we are completely integrated as a system, as a biological system, and we really need those microbiomes for a healthy immune system to operate properly. So it's terribly important that we remember what an integrated system we are, and we are happy for our microbiomes, and a good reason not to take antibiotics too often, by the way. Yes, yeah, thank you.
Steve, your talk about mind and brain got me to thinking, if the mind is not all brain-based, does it survive after the brain is damaged or is destroyed? My question to both of you is there any evidence one way or the other?
Well, you've probably heard about this new book by Evan Alexander, the neurosurgeon who used to work at Harvard for years, and you know he has this new best-selling book on his near-death experience. And the claim there that he makes is that when he was in a coma for about a week or so, that his brain had stopped, but he had all these incredible experiences, and it was evidence of consciousness surviving. Well, near death or consciousness in some heightened state, even though the brain had basically flatlined. And that claim has generated a huge amount of controversy. He has backtracked, I think, somewhat on that. I have not read his book, but what I've heard is that when he's been presented with, well, you would have died if your brain had totally shut down, he said, yeah, it probably was operating at some minimal level. That's obviously an open question about whether consciousness can have some independent existence apart from what an individual's brain is going on. And it's too bad that we only have about 3 minutes left in it. I mean, this is a huge question. And I mean, I alluded earlier in my talk to him, and I actually think consciousness is the big issue in the science and religion debate. I mean, in the public discourse, it's all evolution. It's all, you know, can you reconcile how to read the Bible with science, and at the intellectual level, I don't think that's a very interesting question, actually. Consciousness is a hugely interesting question, but we might have to save that for another time.
The next year's holiday lecture, how about, yes.
Can I add a point?
Sure.
Oh, I just wanted to add a point, obviously, that, I mean, my personal view on that would be that I don't think there's any scientific data that can really address that question. Those sort of out-of-the-body experiences and so on are interesting, but there's so many other ways of understanding those, I think, which make that, one should be a little bit cautious about extrapolating those data too far. Of course, I mean, a lot depends on one's own religious worldview and so forth. I mean, I happen to be a Christian, so I do believe, you know, that clearly there will be the resurrection of the body. And I think what's interesting, actually, is that in the whole idea of the resurrection of the body, that it's quite a sort of physical, not physical in this material sense, but in the sense that there's a very strong emphasis on personhood continuing after death. It's not some abstract sort of consciousness floating around in the ether, but very rooted in the concept of body, and that's a very Hebrew concept, actually. So obviously it depends very much one's own framework and matrix where one's coming from is the kind of answer I think you would give to that question.
If I can just add one thing, as I mentioned, I just did this big radio series on consciousness, and so I interviewed lots of very prominent philosophers, neuroscientists, and the most surprising thing that I came across is there are now some people, very highly respected scholars who talk about consciousness as being a fundamental property of nature, consciousness itself. In other words, you cannot reduce it to biology or chemistry or physics. And, you know, there's sort of this idea that, you know, if you can't reduce it to physics, then it's not real. David Chalmers, one of the leading philosophers of mind in the world, has basically come out with this idea. It's sometimes referred to as panpsychism. Christoph Koch, one of the founders of sort of the modern study of neuroscience, he and Francis Crick, famous atheist, they really pioneered the study of the neural correlates of consciousness back in the late 70s, early 80s. He has come out. Christoph Koch, most people would describe as a materialist. He has said he thinks probably consciousness is a fundamental property of nature that cannot be reduced to the other fields of science. Pretty fascinating stuff. This is the minority view among neuroscientists, though.
Interesting. Okay.
I wanted to ask Mr. Paulson, you seem to set up a dichotomy suggesting that the subconscious mind is less analytic than the conscious mind. Do you want to comment on that?
Really, to me, that seems fairly apparent, actually, that the subconscious is less analytic. I think most of us would say that sort of the process of analysis, I mean, let's say, I don't know, take an example of you're writing a paper, you know, the sort of that critical faculty that you go and you go back and you correct. I mean, I think that's more of a conscious activity rather than a subconscious activity. I mean, of course, our unconscious, our subconscious is you know, deciding to do certain things or not certain things. And my larger point is I think that we have, in these discussions about free will, we tend to try to only talk about that at the conscious level, and I think there's probably actually a lot of interaction between the two, and I think it's much more fluid than we tend to realize.
Thanks. Right over here.
Yes, I'm interested in the posing of the question. Are we only our genes? Is our consciousness only our brain? What is the assumption behind this, and why is the tendency to go back to this assumption?
Thank you. That's a very good question, I think. And I think probably one of the factors going on here is simply just the power of scientific narratives and the power of scientific methods all the time to be dissecting, taking things to bits, telling narratives through the eyes of a molecular biologist or a geneticist or a neuroscientist. And these are incredibly powerful stories, and with their own context, they're very, very good at giving good explanations. And I think it's terribly tempting, you know, if you're in that field and you spend your lifetime in one particular field, you end up really believing, you know, that is the story that counts. It's very hard to see other narratives, I think, if you're because science is so specialized these days. And so all our scientists get buried in, I worked on one molecule for 20 years, you know. Okay, it wasn't the only thing we were doing, but you know, it was one molecule. Rather important one, actually, but anyway. So this is the problem, you know, that we, because of this, kind of methodological reductionism, you know, the approach of science, if you want to find out how something works, take it to bits. It's a very good approach, nothing wrong with that at all. But scientists sometimes aren't so good at putting the bits back together again. And so it's quite hard sometimes, I think, for people in science particularly to stand back and see the picture as a whole. And what's great, I think, about current biology actually is there's a much bigger tendency now, you know, to work with whole animals, to work with mice, as I used to do, and whatever, you know, to work with the whole systems, whereby if you're an immunologist, for example, you have to look at the whole organism. So it gives, well, if you like, a more holistic emphasis on the whole thing. You have to look at the system as a whole. But I do think when these things are reported out in the public domain, they're often, very often, reported fragmentally. You don't often get the big picture. So that leads to this kind of idea of nothing buttery. This was this lovely phrase by the late Donald Mackay, who was a neuroscientist, actually, who was a great critic of the idea of nothing buttery, that something is nothing but, you know, we are nothing but neurons, nothing but genes, and so on. So I think we have to be, you know, if we see this language appearing either within the scientific literature or indeed in the reporting of science, whereby you see the words nothing but or only, that should already be giving us sort of orange warning lights, you know, that there's something, there's ontological reductionism being smuggled in through the back door here. when really what they're on about is methodological reductionism. If you take the system to bits, that's the description level that we're going to report now in this paper. But methodological reduction is very different from ontological reductionism, which is actually saying that's all it is and nothing more. And I think that's a categorical error, I think, actually.
But may I, but just one follow-up. Is your DICI, is that becoming more generally acceptable as a thought process?
Well, as an acronym, I just made it up this year. So give it some time. I mean, it's a bit of a mouthful. It's not nearly as jingly as nature nurture, but you know, I got some hopes for it. We'll see how it goes.
Okay, I'm afraid we're going to have to close this, but we'll take one more. Can you make it very quick? And we'll.
Thank you so much.
Oh, wait.
Regarding the impact.
Sorry. Oh, okay. I'm getting a protest from the audience that they want both questions. So, all right. So remember, your reception is being delayed because of the popular vote. But very quickly, please.
I'll be very short. Thank you. Regarding the impact of religion on human development at large scale, I'm being told that in Brazil, the impact of evangelical church has been beyond any parameter we can measure with. How is there any study? What is your opinion regarding the impact of development of evangelical church in Brazil on human development, which is now widely documented, but recently documented? Any comment regarding?
I'm not sure I really understand the question, but did you?
Okay, I'm sorry, I've never been to Brazil, and I'm not an expert in that area at all. But if it's a fact, I'm glad. I mean, you know, that if people are being helped by a particular movement, I think that's a good thing. But I don't think I can really comment, because I don't know enough about it. Sorry about that.
So there's some, you're commenting on some interrelationship between a religious movement in Brazil with
Religion, not necessarily evangelical,
right,
only, and human development.
And so here would be an environmental
and economic development by way of consequence.
Here would be.
Can I broaden the question? But I think there's an important point here that, I mean, just that thing about positive social movements, religious and otherwise, going on around the world, and people probably wouldn't think about genomes, you know, human genomes when they're thinking about that. But actually, I think we all have a responsibility to be caring not only for the environment around us, which is where the discussion normally lies, but also caring for our own genomes as well. And those sort of movements can actually, interestingly, again, be integrated with our own genomes, that we have a responsibility towards the care and health of our own genomes. And there is quite, I mean, certainly there's good animal and plant evidence, you know, that the effects of certain environmental changes can be transmitted transgenerationally in epigenetic terms. And there's human evidence for that for at least one generation, possibly two generations. This arises out of the great hunger famine year of in Holland in 1944 and so on, and the impact on the as yet unborn fetuses that were being carried by mothers who experienced starvation and so on. Those have been tracked through now to the next generation. There are epigenetic changes that have been measured in the children and so on. So those are other extreme examples, but I think more broadly speaking, nutrition, healthcare, development are all integrated with our genomes in ways that people don't often think about. And we, by our own lifestyles, you know, may be affecting not only our children, but also our children's children epigenetically as well. It's a sort of sobering thought, and it comes into the whole issue of development and improving environments in terms of nutrition, healthcare, and so on.
Okay, thank you. Last question, please.
Sure. My name is Brother Athanasius from the Dominican House of Studies in D.C. Regarding the question of free will, whether it's from a genetic or neural perspective, what kind of scientific data would prove the thesis of determinism that was mentioned in your talk?
Okay. What kind of scientific data would prove the thesis of determinism? I was using my definition of determinism with a genetic spin because it was a talk about genetics. The definitions determinism in the neuroscience sort of free choice discussion would be quite different, I think, actually. Well, similar, but they would use different language. But I think they would go somewhat along the lines of hard determinism would be the idea that our lives are constrained to one particular future. We don't have any option. It's so you lose the up-to-usness that is a characteristic of the experience of having what I would want to call free choice. Can I just make a point on that, actually? I think it's probably an easier, so it's always a difficult discussion. It might be a slightly easier discussion if we use the term free choice. Free will is a very tricky terminology, isn't it? So personally, I would prefer to use the term free choice. But that's a huge discussion.
I think if you, speaking of how could you prove this in terms of the brain question, if you could program a computer basically to replicate the neural correlates that you would find in the brain, and you would reproduce that in silicon and create the same conscious experience in a computer, that might be a good step to saying that this could all be programmed.
Oh dear.
Okay, is this still working? Can I just mention one old argument, which I think is a good one, which is not a proof of free will or free choice, but it's actually by this late Donald Mackay, the neuroscientist. He pointed out, in fact, let's say I'm a super scientist and I can see all the inputs into your brain, completely all the synaptic connections, exactly what they're doing. So I can be in a position to predict, in 2 minutes' time, you're going to eat a chocolate biscuit. You have a choice, a chocolate biscuit instead of the plain biscuit. Okay, so does that mean that you don't have free choice? He would say no. Why does that so? Well, because if you're making predictions in science, they have to be predictions that are valid for anyone anywhere in this planet. Okay, that's what a prediction entails. Okay, and in this particular case, that prediction doesn't fulfill that promise. And the reason is because if I tell you my prediction, okay, so everyone has to know what that prediction is going to be if it's going to be validated. If I tell you that prediction, then your brain state will go out of date, and you may then want to choose, I'm not going to do that, I'm going to choose a plain biscuit. Okay. Now, of course, because I'm a super scientist, I can also build into my equation my fact of having told you, that prediction. And, okay, so follow through the argument. You get an infinite regress. It turns out, in fact, because of the strange situation, which is the strange situation of being an agent, the actual one who's making the decision, there is no prediction that's valid for anywhere in the universe to believe or not, which you have to do, which constrains you to a particular future in the sense it cannot be predicted because the actual agent is always able to say, no, I'm not going to do it. Or it will, if you like, put in more scientific terms, it will also invalidate my prediction about your brain state because my having told you will immediately invalidate your brain state. Now, I don't think that it's just a reflection on the very mysterious fact of being an agent and of making decisions. I don't think it's some sort of proof for free choice or free will. But I think it's something to reflect on, probably as we have our refreshments, isn't it?
Absolutely. Yes. Thank you. Hold it. I want to, before we close here, I want to invite you in February. The AAAS has an annual meeting every year. The convention in February is in Boston. The DoSER program will be sponsoring three symposia there. One is Partners for the Earth, how scientists and religious communities can work together for environmental care. One is on the brain-machine interface, and one is on synthetic biology, as well as our DoSER reception that we have there. So I invite you to look up the annual AAAS meeting in Boston on the AAAS website and come join us in mid-February. And I invite you now to our reception. Please, let's give our grateful thanks to Denis Alexander and Steve Paluson. Yeah.